The French Chef is made possible by a grant from the Polaroid Corporation.
This is a daube de bœuf à la Provençale. And here is carbonade de bœuf à la Provençale. We're doing beef get stewed two ways today on The French Chef. French Chef. I'm Julia Child. We're doing two beef stews today on the French Chef, and for them we need lots of onions. So I'm going to start chopping them right away. And when you need lots of onions, it's a good idea to learn how to use the knife so you can chop them very quickly. And I like to use a great big knife because it's heavy and very sharp and it does most of the work for you. And I hold it with my thumb and finger this way, and then I just chop straight down like this. And you can do it very quickly indeed. Now, these are all peeled onions and you chop it in half. There's your root end there, and you chop it between the root like this. And then you chop off two little ends where the roots and the stem were, and that's going to release the slices. And you hold the onion, there's your thumb there, and here your fingers here, and then you just come right straight down. There, I'll do that once more. See, there's your onion, laying it flat down, and then cut off about two thin slices from each one of the ends, and then with your thumb there and your fingers this way, come right down. You can see that's really very quick to do indeed. Be sure that you get yourself some sharp knives. I think this shape is very good. And we're going to have for the first beef stew which we're making, which is called carbonade de bœuf à la Provençale, we're going to have about 5 or 6 cups of onions. And for the second beef stew, which is its cousin, we'll be having about 3 cups of sliced onions. So we need lots together. And the carbonade consists of onions and potatoes and beef, and we're going to make a recipe for 6 people. And the kind of beef we're going to use are slices of chuck steak. This is a very nice, fairly tender piece of meat, and you should have them sort of in serving slices, which are about 3.5 by 2.5 by about 1/2 inch thick. And we're going to marinate the beef. And marination means that we're going to soak it in a flavored liquid. And I'm just going to turn down one of my stews here and move it over. And a marinade is just a flavored liquid. And the reason you want to marinate is, if you want to take the time, is to give the meat flavor and also to tenderize it. And besides, it's a traditional part of this recipe if you want to do it. And for this, we're going to use red wine vinegar and olive oil and garlic and pepper and thyme and savory. And we're going to put in about 1/4 cup of red wine vinegar. And 1 tablespoon of olive oil or cooking oil. And some good grinds of pepper, about 1/8 teaspoon. And about 3/4 teaspoon each of ground dried savory and of thyme. And then we're going to have some garlic. We want to have 2 large cloves of garlic, and you can either put the garlic in with a garlic press, and if you don't have a garlic press, you can do what many of the French chefs do, which just take your great big knife and lay the garlic on the table and go whack with your fist and then just cut it up. And this doesn't have to be anything but rather roughly chopped. And then we should stir it up with a wooden spoon, and you want to marinate for at least 6 hours. If you don't have a 6 hour marinade, you might just as well not have done it. And you can marinate it between 6 hours and 2 or 3 days and put it covered in the refrigerator and then turn it around every once in a while whenever you think of it. And you don't have to marinate if you don't want to, but it's rather fun to do. If you don't marinate, you simply add all these ingredients to your stew later on when we assemble it, and I'll tell you when it is that we do it. And then we have, I think you remember the ingredients that for that. We then have some fresh, we have all of these onions that are going to cook, and we also have to cook the onions first in something. And traditionally, one cooks it in fresh, lean bacon. That's fresh, unsmoked, unsalted bacon. And that's awfully hard to get. So you can use a fresh pork butt, which is rather fat. So I think that's what I will use. And we want to cut this up into 1 inch, sort of one, not 1 inch, about half inch pieces. And then we're going to sauté that in some oil. And you don't have to use the pork butt if you don't want to, but it's just part of the recipe. If you don't want to use it, you just omit it altogether and use plain oil to cook your onions in. And we just want a little bit of oil in the pan, probably about a tablespoon, just so that it'll start it off. And we want about 2/3 cup of that fresh pork butt. And then while we are letting our pork butt cook so that it will render out its fat, I always think that sounds so funny, pork butt, but it's actually the shoulder butt. And that's somewhere up in the shoulder. I'm not exactly sure, but it's rather fatty. And so it's a very good thing to use. You want to cook that for 3 or 4 minutes. And while that is cooking, we can get to our potatoes, because we need about 6 or 7 cups of sliced potatoes to go in this recipe too. And again, this is a matter of slicing. And of course, there's several ways to slice. If you're handy with the knife, you'd slice your potato just as you would onions. You take your peeled potato and cut it in half, and then put the flat end down so it'll be easy to cut, and use the same motion with your thumb at one end and your fingers curled back, and just cut like that. That goes very quickly indeed. And then if you happen to be an old-fashioned type and your grandmother, in her will, might have left you an instrument like this, which is called a mandolin. And it has all kinds of knobs and blades. And it has a very sharp blade here, which you can use for slicing potatoes. Your grandmother probably used it for making sauerkraut. You see, that slices them up very nicely. And then if you're extremely modern, and you have an electric mixer with one of these tremendous attachments on, you just put your peeled potato in, and there you are with sliced potatoes. So it doesn't make any difference how you slice them. You're going to need 6 or 7 cups of potato for this recipe. And these should be boiling potatoes or all-purpose. You do not want to use baking potatoes, because you want potatoes to keep their shape as they're cooking. And now we'll look at our pork fat. You see that's rendered a bit of oil. It really should cook probably 4 or 5 minutes more, but I'm not going to let it, because everyone knows how to do that. And then we want to have about 6 cups of onions. That would be almost 2 pounds of sliced onions. And this is the kind of a recipe where the exact ingredients don't make a great deal of difference. Matter of fact, I think I've got too many there, because I want some for my other recipes, so I'm going to take them out. There. And then these you want to cook slowly for about 20 minutes after you've stirred them up and gotten them covered with the oil. Then you would put a cover on the pan and let them cook very slowly, turning them and stirring them every once in a while until they were very, very lightly browned. And then when they're done, they will be lightly browned and look like this. And so now we have our onions cooked and we have our potatoes sliced, and we're now ready to assemble our carbonade à la Provençale. And I'll get my casserole. And first we put about a third of our onions in the bottom of a casserole. I'm using a 5 to 6 quart casserole, about 4 inches deep. And then we put in our slices of meat. And this all goes in layers. I have probably a little bit over 3 pounds of meat here. And that should serve 6 people very nicely, unless they're terribly, terribly hungry. In that case, 4 people could eat it. Then I put salt and pepper on each layer of meat, and then some more onions, and then some more meat. As you can see, with this kind of a recipe, it doesn't make any difference whether you have one cup less onions or more, because it's one of those kinds of a farm type or peasant type recipes where almost anything goes. And then you have your layers of meat and onions, and then you put on your potatoes. And for this you want about 6 cups of sliced potatoes, and you should actually slice them only at the last minute and not soak them in water, because the potatoes are going to thicken the stew very much like an Irish stew. And if you soak them in the water, that takes the starch out. And the starch is what thickens your juices. Then we have layers of potatoes and salt and pepper. Then I'm going to set this casserole over heat so it'll start heating up while I'm continuing with my potatoes. Then a little more salt and pepper. Oh, I put away my bowl with the marinade ingredients here. Now, as you remember, we had the marinade liquid, which was mostly vinegar and garlic and a little bit of oil and the seasonings. And you could put that marinade ingredients in right now if you were not going to marinate. In other words, either marinate the meat or not, as you choose. And then if you have some nice brown beef stock, either homemade or canned, pour that in. You want to pour it in up to about the top level of the beef, because you don't want to have too much liquid in. And then you bring it up to the simmer, and then you cover it, and you cook it in a 350 degree oven for an hour until your meat is almost tender. Then after an hour of being covered and cooked in your 350 degree oven, you take it out of the oven and you take a two-prong fork and poke in down there and see if the meat seems tender. And if it's almost tender, then you're ready for your second cooking. And if it's not tender, let it cook, say, for half an hour more. And then you uncover it, and you sprinkle it with 1/4 cup of freshly grated Parmesan cheese. And then, if you like, you can put a little more olive oil on just to help the cheese brown. And you can also baste it with a bit of the juices in the casserole. and then you're ready for its final cooking. At this point, you do not have to continue cooking. You can set it aside and let it cool and then refrigerate it. Then when you're ready to cover it, to finish cooking it, put it into a 425 degree oven, uncovered, and let it cook for half an hour longer, or until the top is nicely brown and everything is bubbling and the potatoes are beautifully cooked. So there is your carbonade de bœuf à la Provençale, and it makes a delicious sort of main course meat and potato dish. And then our second casserole is Daube de bœuf à la Provençale, and it also contains onions, but it doesn't contain any potatoes. I'll just remove some of these early things, but keep my onions. And the Daube de bœuf has onions and carrots and tomatoes and mushrooms, as well as herbs and seasonings. And we use the same kind of meat. For the first stew, we used an undercut of the chuck, which is a very nice meat that will cook perfectly well in about an hour and a half. And for the Daube de bœuf, you would use the same cut, either, I think the chuck is about as good as anything, the undercut of the chuck, that's up in the upper part of the body. And for this, you would cut the meat up into about 2.5-inch chunks, about an inch thick. And again, for 6 people, you'd need 3 pounds. And this is, like the other one, is sort of an assembly job of cut vegetables. We have onions, and we want a cup and a half each of carrots. There's a peeled carrot, and you'd slice it exactly the same way. And then we want a cup and a half of fresh mushrooms. These are washed mushrooms, and they're going to be sliced the same way. I don't even need to take the stems out, because this is whenever you have a sort of a peasant type dish like this, you don't have to be fancy. There. So there are mushrooms, and then we have tomatoes. Should have a little dish here. And then we want a cup and a half of peeled, seeded, and juiced tomatoes, which are called tomates concassées. And this is a peeled tomato. And to do that, you just drop a firm, ripe, red tomato in boiling water and boil it for exactly 10 seconds, and then cut out the stem, and then cut the tomato in half through the stem, and then put your hand in like that and just squeeze it, and then cut it into pieces, and then you just have the tomato pulp and not the juice. And then the juice and the seeds you can use for soups or gravies or something like that. Now we have our meat, which has to be seasoned and floured. What's nice about these two stews is they're really nothing but an assembly job. They're much more simple than the formal stew, such as bœuf bourguignon. Now there's our pieces of chuck, undercut of chuck or chuck steak, whatever you prefer to call it. When this also is a fairly tender stewing meat with a lot of flavor. There's salt and pepper. Some people like to sort of shake all of this in a sack with the flour, but I prefer to season it all separately so I know what's going on. Now we have flour. I'm just going to sprinkle the flour on the meat there, and then as I put it into the casserole, I'll turn it in the flour. And this, you want to flour the meat only at the last minute, or you're going to get sort of a gooey mess. And then here's our casserole. This is, again, a fireproof, heavy casserole. And then we put all of our, well, first we put all of our vegetables together. I have some onions here that haven't been cut up. We have a cup and a half of each one of these vegetables, so we put them all together. And then we should have some herbs. I'll put in a teaspoon of Italian seasoning. That's an herb mixture. And then we want some more garlic. In this instance, I will put the garlic in with the press. 2 cloves of garlic. And then toss the vegetables all together. That really is going to make a wonderful stew. And then again, you could use some pork if you'd like it. I've got some thick sliced bacon, which has been blanched. That means simmered for 10 minutes in water to take out the bacony, smoky taste. And then you put in a layer of vegetables and then a layer of meat. And the reason that this, the meat is rolled in flour, is so that the flour is going to give a little thickening to the sauce. Then put in some more vegetables and some more meat. All these things seem to go just in layers. I seem to have a little more vegetables than I need. Well, I'll put almost all of them in. And then set that over heat, and then we add some liquid. And in this instance, if you like to, you can use wine or you can use stock. And I'm going to use everything. I'm going to put in about a cup of dry white French vermouth. And then if you want to, as added flavor, you can put in some gin, because that has juniper berries. I'll put in about a quarter teaspoon of gin. And then, because all of these vegetables have liquid in them, you don't want to add any more than about a cup and a half of liquid for this amount of meat and vegetables, because you'll find that the liquid will exude from the vegetables. So the best thing to do is to cover the casserole and let it cook for about 10 or 15 minutes and see how the liquid looks, because you don't want the liquid to come more than about halfway up the casserole. And then after you've looked at it for about 15 minutes and you see, well, now maybe the vegetables haven't exuded as much liquid as you'd like, then you could take again a little bit of beef stock or canned beef bouillon and just add a little bit of liquid. And then cover the casserole and cook it. You can cook it either in a 325 degree oven, or you can cook it on top of the stove if you have a nice heavy casserole like this. And it depends on the quality of your meat. With this good beef chuck that I have, it shouldn't take more than about 2 hours. And again, you can tell when it's done by poking it with your fork. And as soon as it's tender, it's ready to eat. And you can serve it then just as it is, or I've got one here that has cooked for the required amount of time and is nice and tender. And we're going to make for this. It's perfectly fine to serve just as it is now, because everything is all done and ready. But we can do a little Provençal fillet to it, or a final flavoring, which is rather nice. I don't know how it's still. And also, you can, another Provençal thing is you can put in a little bit of saffron, these little flowery things. That gives an interesting bit of flavor to it. And for this other flavoring, I'm going to again use some garlic. And I think I shall whack it up in this way just because it's fun. Beat it up that way. And then put it in a little bowl. And then mash it up. And then I'll use 3 tablespoons of capers. These are these little black, little wonderfully flavorful things that just taste like capers that have come in wine vinegar. And then put in some strong Dijon mustard. About 2 or 3 tablespoons, I think, would be nice for that. In this also you can do whatever you feel like. Some people put in anchovies, and that all gets nicely beaten around. And then I think a little bit of oil would be nice. That is very much of a Provençal enrichment of olive oil. I have a spoon here somewhere. And just a little tiny bit of olive oil just to give it that je ne sais quoi. And then about 1/3 cup of chopped parsley. And then this you can make ahead of time and when you're ready to serve, you take your casserole off of heat and stir in your enrichment. I don't even smell the gin in there. That was about 1/4 cup that I put in. I put in 1/2 cup in this because this is about twice as much. So I'm going to now take this off heat and stir in the Provençal enrichment. Also, if you had some basil, fresh chopped basil, that would be lovely. But this is an extremely nice kind of an end to the stew, and that smell of fresh garlic is just lovely. There we are with our 2 beef stews, and I'm going to serve you some of each so you'll see how they look. And here is our Daube de Beouf à la Provençal with all its vegetables, and that lovely fresh garlic flavor that we put in at the very end. And with the Daube de Beouf, I think probably noodles would be good. You don't need any other vegetables because you have all of your onions and tomatoes and everything else in it. So here are some buttered curlicue noodles. And that makes a lovely dish. And then here we have our Carbonade à la Provençal. And with that, you can serve fresh green beans. So that's all for today on The French Chef. This is Julia Child. Bon appétit.
Julia Child is co-author of the book Mastering the Art of French Cooking.